Hello and welcome to NASA's Digital Learning Network. My name is Rachel Power and I am the host here at NASA's Kennedy Space Center. I have with me today a very special guest, Dr. Kathleen Morse. She works with the Advanced Materials Applications out in California, and she's here today to talk about her project that will be flying aboard ISS. And we also happen to be connected to a school. It's out in Houston, Texas. This is the AUTI International School, and I would love for you guys to unmute your microphones. And Mrs. Blackwell, I'd love for you to tell us a little bit about your school and how are you guys connected to CASIS and the International Space Station?
Well, we are an international school, and we have students. We represent, actually, our student body represents 52 different countries. So we have quite a diverse student body. We're a pre-K through 12 school, so our juniors and seniors do the International Baccalaureate program, so it's a very rigorous type program. And this past summer, basically my principal or headmaster came to me and said, hey, there's this great program going on. CASIS is sponsoring what they call the National Design Challenge, and they're picking three schools in Houston, and one of those schools happened to be AUTI. And so they decided to do it with our fifth grade and our eighth grade, and I teach the eighth grade science. So that's sort of how it sort of fell into my lap, which was really kind of neat because I've always done a lot of stuff with NASA, a lot of their teacher programs, that sort of thing. So that's how we basically got started with it.
Well, it's kind of interesting then. So CASIS manages the U.S. International Space Station Science Laboratory. And so they do projects with both educators and scientists. Mm-hmm. And so we happen to have both the education side of the house and the science side of the house here doing similar type of research. And so Dr. Kathleen Morse is here, and she's going to talk a little bit about what she's working on and share some of her project with you guys. And then we'll open it up for questions. But those of you watching live on the web, you're also welcome to ask questions. We have two opportunities for you to ask questions. You can either tweet them to us. So you can tweet them with hashtag AskDLN, or you can also send us an email. And our email address is dlinfochannel@gmail.com. I'll be checking the tweets and the Gmail account and looking for your questions. But in the meantime, I would love for you to get us started and share with us kind of how you got started on this journey.
I'd love to. So I want to start off this discussion with the question, would your cell phone work in space? So here's my cell phone. And the cell phone actually has a lot of ideal characteristics that a satellite would basically benefit from. It's small in size and low in weight, so it doesn't cost much money to get it actually into space. It actually also uses very little power, which is a benefit to us on Earth when we're carrying around our cell phones, but is a huge benefit in space where power is at a premium. And it's also extremely computationally powerful. I don't think a lot of people realize that the cell phones we carry around are much more powerful than the laptops we used to have a few years ago. So this is just some of the incredibly beneficial characteristics of our cell phones. So there are some programs, such as at NASA, Google, and other programs, are actually working to put cell phones into space and to test them out there. And so we are specifically focusing on developing a space computer product that's going to use the computer chip that's in these cell phones. But to start off our conversation today, I just want to focus on the idea of the cell phone as our satellite in space. So the question is, would your cell phone work in space? So to discuss this today, we have to know the kind of environment that the satellite space phone needs to survive. So in that environment, we have the sun and our magnetic fields, which create the Van Allen belts around Earth. So those are two major influences. And then the sun itself is extremely dynamic. I'll show a video regarding that. And then I'm going to describe the fact that where you are in your orbit around Earth can really affect the kind of radiation your electronics will see and their performance. And then after that, I'll discuss the radiation effects that can occur in your cell phone electronics. So these include single event effects in which one effect can potentially take out the whole performance of your cell phone / cell phone satellite. Another effect is total ionizing dose. which can also basically inhibit the performance of your cell phone and basically make it not usable anymore. I'll also describe ways to mitigate these effects so that you can basically, you know, successfully fly your cell phone in space. And then I'll describe ways that you can test your cell phone on Earth through ground testing so that you can evaluate its performance prior to paying for that expensive launch into space. So as I mentioned, the space environment is made up both of the sun, which is about 93 million miles from Earth. But regardless, it plays a major factor in our radiation space environment, both at Earth, outside of Earth, and then further out in the solar system. The sun typically emits solar protons and heavy ions along with other particles, but it's the solar protons and the heavy ions that actually give us a lot of our single event effects. And then the Earth has its own magnetic field, as you can see from those yellow field lines down below. And what happens is those field lines trap particles coming from the sun, both electrons and protons, to create what we call the Van Allen belts. So to talk about the sun, I'm starting up this video here. And this is the video from the Solar Hemispherical Observatory. This has been in orbit around Earth and the Sun for about 20 years so far, 18 years specifically. And what you can see here is that the Sun is a very dynamic force in our solar system in terms of emanating a lot of powerful radiation. So what you're seeing here is just the corona of the Sun. And this is a time-lapse video. And what you're seeing are you see coronal mass ejections, which are like explosions from the sun that basically emanate particles that can vary in magnitude and energy levels by many, many orders of magnitude. Our sun has solar cycles. So for about 4 years, the sun is extremely active. And then 7 years, by comparison, it's much quieter. And while it's very active, sometimes we'll actually shut down some of our space satellites orbiting Earth and in other regions. We'll put it into a sleep mode to minimize the potential hazards that the space radiation can wreak on electronics. So this is a very powerful force that we do keep an eye on, and we sometimes do modify our missions, and we actually will power off electronics temporarily just to basically avoid some of these detrimental effects, which could take a mission completely offline.
Now, were you planning to do your mission based off of the solar cycle? Did it have any effects?
I did not. We're going to be in a benign environment, an environment of relatively low radiation, and I'll describe that in the slides later.
Okay.
But, you know, this is something to consider, especially if you're outside our Van Allen belts, outside the Earth, in the geosynchronous orbit, for instance, that would be more of an issue than in a low Earth orbit. Here's a cross-section of the Van Allen belts around Earth. So we have that magnetic field that emanates from the Earth, and particles from the sun get trapped in these Van Allen belts. So they can create the inner Van Allen belt that you see there, which we call, it's a proton-heavy region. And then further out, you have the outer Van Allen belt, which is primarily consists of electrons. And typically, you'd want to be flying your electronics in the inside or anywhere outside these Van Allen belts, because the Van Allen belts can cause a higher rate of single event effects, and they can also will give you a higher total ionizing dose result. And you'll see that a little bit more in the later slides. So in this slide, if we look at the plot on the right, which is a contour plot, you see the Earth, which is this gray circle. And then on the left side of that, you see a series of contours. And that's showing the protons with an energy of greater than 10 million electron volts. And so about 1 to 2 Earth radii out, you'll see that there's a concentration of these protons. And this makes up the inner Van Allen belt. And then on the right side of that, of the Earth, correct, you'll see the electron distribution at energy greater than 1 million electron volts. And it's around 4 to 5 Earth radii out in that red region that you'll see the primary concentration of electrons. So these places where you have a high concentration of electrons or protons, ideally for your cell phone satellite, which is based on commercial electronics, you'll want to stay outside of these regions. And going back to that slide, if you look on the plot on the left, we haven't really discussed total ionizing dose yet in much detail, but this is kind of an initial discussion. Unlike single event effects, total ionizing dose occurs from all the ionizing radiation that's absorbed in your electronics. And so if you look at the plot shows dose versus altitude, which is responding, is basically correlates to your orbit, you'll see that in low Earth orbit, which we call LEO in this plot, this is a typical, around this area is the typical orbit of the ISS. This is going to be one of the lowest areas of total ionizing dose radiation. It's a great place for your commercial electronics to fly, and also a lot of the communication satellites fly there. Then you see two bumps on the curve, and those bumps each correspond to the Van Allen belts. And then on the outer one, you see the GEO orbit, which is our geosynchronous orbit, where, again, we have a lot of satellites flying, and that's another region of lower total ionizing dose radiation. And interestingly enough, in the GPS orbit, it's actually slightly inside the one of the Van Allen belts, but because of shielding of electronics, this is why you can fly electronics successfully in that orbit. We contact the GPS satellites whenever we're using our cell phones and want to use the map function. So you actually probably use that every day and you may not even realize. Okay, next. So if we took the cover off of your cell phone, this is what you would see is this picture on the left. The cell phone has a lot of features inside of it, hence making it kind of an ideal satellite. It has several antennas which are used for communication. One is your GPS satellite antenna. Another one is the Wi-Fi antenna. So whenever you go into a library to access the internet, or if you're at a coffee shop and you want to check out your email, this is what you're accessing on your phone. You're accessing the Wi-Fi antenna. And another, so these cell phones also contain batteries along with other controls that operate your touch panel. But another important feature here is the computer chip. The computer chip is the engine for your cell phone. It basically, you can perform a lot of operations on your cell phone, and you know, you will basically get seamless response. And this is because you have such a powerful computer on here. It's performing so many calculations so quickly, it's as if, you know, it's as if nothing's happening, but there's actually quite a bit happening, but in our time scale, we can't see it. So that's how powerful your computer is. So if we zoomed in on that computer chip, this would be the image on the right. So that computer chip is made up of millions of transistors, and that is truly nanotechnology. A lot of the feature sizes in your computer chips contain nano-sized features. If we even look closer, you can see below that kind of an outline of one of the types of transistors that would be in your phones. So I know a lot of high school students have not had solid-state physics or quantum mechanics yet, so I encourage you to take that later in college. But today we're going to describe the basic function of the transistor as a light switch. So your computer chip contains millions of these transistors, and these transistors are performing millions of operations per second. So each of these transistors can either be on, in which current is flowing, since your light switch would be on, and this would have a Boolean expression of 1, or it can be off. The light switch has been turned off, no current is flowing, and this would have a Boolean expression of 0. The important takeaway here is that these transistors are affected by space radiation. So this is why it's important to understand how these computers will operate on the ground prior to being put in space, so you can find a robust technology for your cell phone satellite. So there are several kinds of radiation effects that can occur in cell phone electronics. So we talked first about single event effects, in which one particle, a proton or a heavy ion, which you'll both see both of those in low Earth orbit, those can create three different kinds of effects. So the first effect is called latch up, in which there is a short circuit in your cell phone, and I'll describe that more on a later slide. There's a single event functional interrupt, in which you're basically putting inputs into your cell phone and you get nothing out. It's as if it's not responding to you anymore. That's a single event functional interrupt. Your processor hangs. Then you have a single event upset, which is actually a miscalculation. So you're calculating data all the time as part of the function of your computer, computer slash cell phone satellite. And you can actually get erroneous process data back because of single event upsets. So this is primarily a function of something going wrong in your computer memory, and I'll describe that later. And then finally, you can get total ionizing dose effects. So this is different. This is all the ionizing radiation that's absorbed in your electronics can yield a total ionizing dose result that takes your electronics out of specification so they no longer work. So this slide summarizes what latch-up is. So we had done tests at the facility in Boston recently, Proton facility, and if you take a look at the curve on the left here, you see current of our computer chip, which is similar to your the chip in your cell phones. You look at current versus time. And what you're seeing here is the current's bouncing around, and then at some point, it just latches up. There's a short circuit that develops in the transistor, and it basically is no longer changing its current level. And so if you take a look on the right image here, you get the equivalent circuit of what's happening inside your transistors. Basically, there's a current flow that's like a short circuit, and there's no discharge of this current. It just continues to flow and flow and flow. And sometimes these latch-ups can actually be high current latch-ups. And the current that continues to flow can actually lead to long-term effects, basically burn out the insides of your electronics. So it's really important to be able to detect this effect and then turn off your cell phone and repower it to restore it. But this is one mitigation technique for latch-up. Another kind of single event effect is called a single event functional interrupt. So as we spoke of earlier, the processor just hangs. So no matter what kind of inputs you put into your cell phone, it just hangs. So if you look at the plot on the bottom here, this is another test that we did at our Proton facility on the ground. You see voltage as a function of time. And we have our computer chip that's periodically sending out a voltage. Plus 1 volt, 0 volt. Plus 1 volt for 1 second, 0 volt for 1 second, periodically, like a heartbeat. So at some point, it just doesn't respond anymore. There's no heartbeat, so it's kind of dead. So that is the beginning of a single event functional interrupt. So we recovered from this effect by turning off the electronics. As you can see, the current flow in the red curve below, we turned it off. And that, when we turned it back on, it changed the state of your of the voltage from 0 to 1. And then eventually the heartbeat continues again, so that's further down on the curve. But as you can see, if we didn't detect that and do something about it, we would have lost our payload in space. We would have lost our cell phone satellite. Okay, so I'm going to briefly discuss computer memory. So you have memory inside your cell phone. So when you take photographs, for instance, with your cell phone, those images are being stored in computer memory. And that computer data is actually contained in what we call memory cells. So memory cells are like buckets. You can have a filled memory cell, which is like a filled bucket, as you see on the picture on the right. And when it's filled, it has a Boolean expression of 1, and it's in a charged state. The other state for memory cells is that it can be empty, as the bucket on the right there, in which it's been discharged, and it has a Boolean expression of 0, and it's in an empty state. So the actual state of these memory cells can be affected by radiation, and we'll describe that on the next slide. So if you take a look at this slide, before we get in there, get into the details of this test, I want to take a step back and talk about the ground test, the proton experiment. So we went to a facility in Boston where we did testing. And as you can see from that image, the upper left right here, we have a cyclotron that we were working on. And so at that blue, I guess it comes across as a blue spot in the middle, is where the protons would have been generated at the facility. And then they're accelerated to the desired energy that we want to expose our parts to. So we accelerated that energy to about 64 million electron volts, which is on the high end of the kind of proton energy that we will see in the ISS orbit. So at the end of this beamline, we had our electronics in a normal angle of incidence to the beam that was coming out. And this is actually, this is our Gumstix project here, as you can see on the lower left, and our Gumstix located at the bottom here. And we lined that up with the beam. And when we took an image of this, where radiation actually exposes an image, you can see the center of the computer chip. So that let us know that we were in alignment with the beam. So getting back to single event effects, we observed single event upsets, which, as we said, are a miscalculation of data. So again, a single event upset is just a change in the state of a memory cell from a 0 to a 1 or 1 to a 0. So it's just a change in state. It's also referred to as a soft error. So if we look at this table here, we actually did an experiment, going back to the table. And we, as we exposed this computer chip to radiation for about 44 seconds at 2 million protons per centimeter squared per second, we actually calculated, we had five miscalculations of the data. And when we correlate this to the actual results that we'd see on the ISS, we project roughly about 2 upsets per day. So if we look at that, that basically means that, you know, if you're taking a picture with your cell phone, it's doing some image processing, we may get 1 or 2 bad pixels a day, which doesn't sound very serious. However, if those upsets occur in the boot up sequence or some other important part in the device that's needed for starting up the processor, et cetera, that could be very detrimental. So this is another thing that you have to mitigate against. And you can actually mitigate that by putting your boot up data or your boot up sequence in another part of the computer to have a backup in case of an error is detected in your other copy. But this is something to consider whenever you're operating electronics, is all the ways that they might fail in space. So as I did a good introduction here, there's several ways to mitigate single event effects in your electronics. As we're going to do on the ISS, we're integrating a watchdog circuit. So we're going to watch for all these single event effects occurring. Once they're detected, we'll actually power down the system and power it back up. We'll also be recording the data just for our edification and data on the actual processor performance. We're also going to implement fault-tolerant architecture. In some cases, we could have redundancy. So in your system, you have a series of systems that perform various functions. Sometimes redundancy is implemented in which you have identical subsystems that will actually come to full operation once a fault has been seen in basically a currently operational subsystem that's no longer working properly. So that's redundancy. For computers, another technique that's used is what we call voting. So you could have 3 computers that are currently operating in lockstep where they calculate one set of data at a time. And then after they've calculated a set of data, they'll compare between each other to see if they came to the same result. That's voting. And when there is a disagreement among them, another computer could be brought online to basically do the same calculation and see which of these computers is reporting accurately. So there are several drawbacks to this technique. You can prevent single event upsets or miscalculation of results. However, it requires a lot more power consumption, which, if you remember, is at a premium in these satellites, especially small satellite systems. It also reduces the number of calculations that can be done per unit time on a satellite system. So as you find when you do spacecraft development, satellite development, there's just a lot of trade-offs. There's benefits and there's an upside and a downside. So it has to be weighed when you're developing your space payload. Yep. So total ionizing dose. I asked a bunch of Florida students this morning who's had a sunburn before. Most of them did raise their hand. And so total ionizing dose is like a sunburn. It's where basically you've exposed your skin to so much, solar radiation that the skin just starts to flake off. So it's not really operating as it was intended to operate. So you've got accumulated damage to your skin. And the same thing can occur with computer electronics. When you have radiation coming from the space environment, after a certain accumulated dose to radiation to your satellite phone here, your space phone, you will start to get parts that come out of specification, just no longer operate properly. So you could lose your space phone in this case. So to look at this a little bit more carefully, our electronics are made up of atoms. And right here you can see a picture on the right that shows the nucleus of the atom and the orbiting electrons. And this radiation can come in, kick off an electron, and leave behind an ion. And when you get enough of this type of event, you can really degrade the performance of your parts. There are several sources of ionizing radiation in space, and these are the protons and electrons in the Van Allen belts. These are the solar protons emitted from the sun, and also the heavy ions and heavy nuclei that come from the sun. So there's several sources. If you could go back to that slide. Okay, it's a little hard to read. So finally, ionizing energy is transferred from radiation and absorbed by the silicon. So we refer to this as the radiation absorbed dose. So you'll refer to usually total ionizing dose in rads. So here is a typical total ionizing dose induced degradation. So you're seeing a curve, a current versus voltage curve for a transistor. The thing you want to notice here is what we call the threshold voltage. Threshold voltage is the voltage at which that light switch switches. So if you've exposed your part to too much ionizing radiation, that level, that voltage level, can shift left or right depending on the kind of MOSFET or the kind of transistor you're working with. And as a result, that light switch won't know any longer to turn on at that voltage. So that's a real problem. So your part basically becomes useless. So you really want to prevent that. And there's an easy way to do that. So to mitigate these total ionizing dose effects, as simple enough as shielding. And I think our friends, the other school, have been working on that aspect of it too. We're actually minimizing shielding in our case because we want to maximize radiation exposure. But to go back to that slide, they're using some of these techniques. So we have the periodic table here. And in their case, they're going to be in the ISS, or the low Earth orbit, where protons are prevalent. So they're using low Z materials, or low atomic number materials, such as carbon-based materials and boron. Aluminum is also commonly used. Now, if you're in an electron-intense orbit, such as the outer Van Allen belt or near that, you'll want to use higher Z materials, such as gold or iron, and some of those are circled there below. And if you're in an environment that has both electrons and protons, you may want to develop a composite material. So it's a fairly straightforward how to shield against total ionizing dose effects. We test for total ionizing dose effects on Earth prior to sending into space. So we may look at two times the worst case environment for total ionizing dose for our mission. Typically, we'll use this cobalt-60 machine shown on the right. We put our electronics at the base of the tower, and then the tower will automatically descend down and expose the electronics to gamma radiation from a cobalt-60 source. Typically emits an energy between 1.17 to 1.33 million electron volts. And it's a very straightforward experiment. Basically, total ionizing dose exposure is linear with time. And then before I sign off, I just want to mention our Gumstix program. So these are actually little computer boards, as shown in the upper left here, that are about the size, literally the size, of a stick of gum. And that little stick of gum contains a lot of processing power. It typically uses an ARM A8 architecture chip. And if you look below, you'll see the print circuit board that's going to be holding four of these gum sticks in positioning this on the outer module on the ISS. That's the NREP right there. So in our experiment, we're going to minimize any shielding from the ISS, so we don't expect any significant shielding from the ISS. We're going to be pointing opposite the velocity direction for the ISS, and we're located specifically outside the Japanese module. So we hope to have a six-month exposure, and then after that, I'll be returned to space for more data analysis. But during exposure, we hope to have semi-real-time information coming from the ISS of basically where both our payload is going to be and also the performance of our payload as a function of where it is around Earth. So in regions such as the South Atlantic Anomaly, typically we would see higher levels of single event effects since there tend to be a higher concentration of protons there. So hopefully we can do a lot of correlation once we've gotten the data back from the ISS. Thank you.
Well, I want to thank you, Dr. Morse, for sharing with us about your research. I'm sure that since you do have some similarities between what's going on over there at Audi, I'm sure the students over there may have some questions for you about what you're working on and how it relates to what they're working on. Maybe you can even provide them some insight. So let me open it up to you guys over at Audi to see if you guys have any questions, and also to remind the folks that are out on the web, if you have questions for Dr. Morse, you are welcome to ask those questions via two methods. We have a Twitter account. Simply tweet with hashtag AskDLN or send them via email to the dlinfochannel@gmail.com. And so with that, Audi, you guys can unmute your microphone and feel free to ask your first question.
Okay, I believe Eleanor has a question.
Hi. Okay, so how much more radiation would there be outside the space station versus inside the space station in our experiment versus yours?
So inside the ISS, you're going to have the benefit of a lot of shielding from all the materials that make up the ISS. That's actually a very challenging question to answer because in different directions, you're going to have more shielding than in others.
Right.
So that's going to be, so it's going to be fairly anisotropic in terms of the distribution. In terms of order of magnitude, I actually am not aware of the specific number, but I will look that up and get that back to you. What I do know is the astronauts do fly with iPads and other things in space, and the rate of single event effects inside the space station is quite low. And I think it's pretty rare that they actually even have a problem with their laptops in space. So it's a pretty benign environment in comparison to outside the ISS.
Okay, cool.
Okay, do you have a question?
How would the shielding that we're researching and you're putting in your project help end some long-term problems for astronauts in terms of like shielding for their spacesuits or even the ISS? How would that help them?
So when we shield our electronics, right, we're using similar techniques as an astronaut would use for shielding themselves from similar radiation. astronauts are not as rad hard as electronics are, so they actually can even tolerate less and less. There is a lot of investigation into other kinds of radiation shielding techniques to really reduce the exposure levels for astronauts. So an interesting story is on the moon. When the Apollo astronauts were on the moon, occasionally, you know, they'd get a sense that a solar flare was coming or some major solar event was coming, and they basically have to go into the most shielded space that they could on the moon. And the astronauts actually do this in space, too. I'm not sure what the region is on the shuttle, the region on the shuttle or the ISS, but they have a region where basically there's the most shielding. So if there is an alert as to major radiation event from the sun coming, they will go into that area. Long-term effects, some of the long-term ways to mitigate radiation effects in astronauts, aside from basic shielding like you described, is also somewhat nutritional. Radiation in the human body can create radicals, free radicals. It can cause a lot of damage to the inside of the body. So you can tie that up with things like blueberries and other things that can basically quench these free radicals so as to minimize the damage. But it's a very big challenge. I think even still to go to Mars, the radiation effects on humans is still a limiting factor. Some have said that, you know, if we were to have a base on the moon, you'd actually want to be under the regolith of the moon. Or if you're on Mars, you want to be, again, buried underneath for most of the time and only occasionally go out for an EVA because of this radiation effect. But, you know, I hope in our lifetimes we solve this problem, because if you're in space, you might as well be looking at the stars and exploring. So it'd be fun to be able to be out there in the environment and checking things out.
And you had mentioned earlier about how there's these pros and cons, and I know that sometimes choosing the right materials may make a spacecraft heavier, which in itself could be a problem in trying to design a spacecraft that can both protect the astronauts but also be light enough to be able, you know, to launch it into to where they're trying to go with a limited amount of fuel. So I was reading somewhere where they were describing the water as being possibly a good material to protect them. So if they surrounded themselves with some of those water bags that they use in space, that might be a way to shield themselves in case of a high dose of radiation.
Fire drill.
Apparently we're having a fire drill.
Excellent. Well, we want you guys to be safe as possible. So we're going to ask you to mute your microphone.
Anyway.
Absolutely. And we'll see you guys back shortly, hopefully. Now, in the meantime, while they safely evacuate the building, we did actually receive our first question via tweet, and I'm not sure how familiar you are with the space elevator. But the question is there any news on advances made in materials that support the construction of a space elevator?
That's a great question. I know there was a lot of hope in carbon nanotubes being able to have the kind of tensile strength and other properties that would be ideal for a space elevator. In terms of carbon nanotubes, one of the biggest challenges with that is basically to have the ideal carbon nanotube properties to realize the ultimate strength that they could achieve. They need to be made very long strands and defect-free, and that's really still technically challenging. But, you know, there are groups that are finding a lot of clever ways to do things. So I think materials and advancement of materials and processing of materials, including nanomaterials, is a really important discipline to pursue, because I think eventually we will make it to the place where we need to be to realize a lot of huge advances.
All right. There's also a question coming in via email. They want to know, how do you mitigate the temperature fluctuations for the gum sticks when they are outside?
That's a great question. So I just did a demo earlier today with some students in Florida here. And so there's several ways to mitigate temperature on Earth. But there are fewer ways to mitigate it in space. And one of the main ways to mitigate temperature fluctuations is to use a combination of radiative cooling and also conduction. Unless your electronic box is in an atmosphere, and it typically won't be if it's put in space, in that case, you can't use convection, which we typically do use on Earth to cool our processors. We usually have a fan in contact or nearby the processor to help, you know, move air that's at room temperature around this. And even for our experiment, we're actually hoping to control the temperature between 0 C to 85 C just for this test. And, you know, we're still waiting on the thermal results from our payload integrator. But this is definitely challenging. But typically in space, you have things that get hot and things that get cold. And you just manage that heat, usually through radiative cooling and conduction.
All right, we have another question, and this one comes from Twitter. Why is there no 1G working environment at the ISS?
I think they do create I don't want to say this the wrong way, but they create environments using basically, don't they use centrifuges to kind of mimic gravity in space? I think they do.
That would be my area of expertise.
This is not my area of expertise, too. I'm not an ISS expert, but I believe they do that kind of work up there. But the people are not at 1G themselves. And why they haven't done a lot of work in that area, I'm not sure why. It just hasn't been a funding focus, I'm guessing, for NASA. So,
now, I'm curious, as an educator, just talking to students all the time, there's a lot of focus right now on women in STEM. This is Women's History Month. So just as a female perspective, can you tell us a little bit about how you got interested in science and kind of your career path? How'd you get to where you are today?
Well, I'm very lucky. I was 5 years old and Cosmos was on the air. My dad's a science teacher, an earth science teacher. So from the time I was probably 3 or 4, he'd look up at the stars and point them out to me, various stars, and tell them what they look like on the stars. So as a little kid, I constantly didn't think of just pinpoints of light in the sky, but I saw worlds to explore out there, and I was just hooked. And I remember seeing Carl Sagan out there in his spaceship of the imagination. And, you know, I had hoped we would have those spaceships by now. But, you know, I'm very encouraged by what's happening in the private and the commercial industry, that we're going to be there sooner than we think. And, you know, we need excellent engineers and scientists. We need entrepreneurs to basically bring their ideas to the table and really revolutionize what's happening. And we're certainly seeing a lot of huge advances from, you know, places like the Spaceship Company, Virgin Galactic, and SpaceX, et cetera. So I'm very encouraged for our future. And one of our goals at our company is to develop very reliable and low-cost space computers that can fit in a CubeSat form factor so that we can make space more accessible and more reliable in terms of operation for satellites in space, so we could do more for less cost.
Can you describe the timeline again for Gumstix and
sure
what's going to be happening with this, so yeah, people can kind of keep an eye out and look for more information?
Well, it's a great program. So I was awarded this around May last year, and basically quickly developed a payload. And so from winning this program last year in May, we're going to be basically launching in around November 27th on the SpaceX rocket.
That's a pretty quick turnaround.
Extremely quick, which is exciting. And so we're going to be launching, and then as soon as it gets up there, it'll be put outside the ISS for 6-month exposure, and then it will be returned back to space roughly 6 months or so later. And then I'll be, you know, basically taking apart the computer to basically look at basically how things have survived in space. So it's very quick turnaround time, which is great for developing computer technology that also advances at a very fast rate. So it's a great vehicle. So I'm feeling very, you know, very lucky to have won this grant. So it's been a great program.
Now, when you say it's going to be put outside the International Space Station, does that mean There's an astronaut who's going to be doing spacewalk that will be physically attaching it to the outside.
So my understanding is there'll probably be a robot that installs it.
Okay.
But the box itself, I was told from NanoRacks, has to meet astronaut kick standards. So if an astronaut's out there and they kick it, it won't break the box. So I guess as they're walking around, it can get tricky. But yeah, it should be robotic.
Astronaut kick.
Yeah, I had never heard of that either.
Now, speaking of astronaut, I was reading in your bio that you were interested in possibly becoming an astronaut at one time. You still are?
Of course.
Can you tell me a little bit about, you know, what, how you were inspired to want to be a part of that program?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, my early starts were, you know, learning about outer space from my dad, who's my, who, you know, was my earth science teacher throughout school. And it's just, it's a passion. So I went, you know, I worked hard in school and I excelled in science and math. And I went on to MIT undergraduate. And then I continued on at Stanford to get my PhD. And along the way, I basically worked on my piloting skills. So I have both a glider pilot's license and a single engine land license. So I've done a lot of the things that astronauts tend to do, and it's a great thing to aspire to because it really does push you to do your best. And, you know, just learning flying can be a little intimidating, but, you know, I did it and I love it. I really adore flying gliders. So, you know, it's, I hope I get to space either with NASA or perhaps with the commercial space industry, but it's a goal I continue to have. And I love science and I love space. So it's just a passion.
Excellent. Yeah. We have some other questions coming in. So let me go ahead and ask this next one. This is from Ice Tech USA. They wanted to know, how long did it take you to devise the Gumstix experiment from the idea to flight? And was that, was CASIS helpful in that process?
So CASIS has been excellent every step of the way. I feel very fortunate. So we're still developing it, but it's close to the end of that process. And we've learned a lot of lessons along the way, which is pretty common for payload development. So I'd say roughly, between May, to what will probably be, March, April timeframe in the next month or so, we should complete that process. So it'd be that time range. So it's less than a year. Wow. So it's aggressive, but you know, it just brings out the best of you and the ingenuity. But we're very excited about this.
How big of a team works on a project like this?
So basically in our team, we have our company, Advanced Materials Applications. So there's two of us in the company working on this. And then we have, our payload developer is AstroDev. So they're working with us on the watchdog aspect of the payload. And so it's basically, it could be a team of three or four people. None of us are working part time, because the budget can't support that. But, it's, you know, depending on how many man hours or women hours you need, it's roughly a team of about four people, maybe quarter time. Yeah.
And in developing this particular, project, this research question, what triggered you to want to do this in particular?
That's a great question. So I was told about the CASIS opportunity. It was actually September in 2012. And, you know, I went with one of the people who would be on my team, and we just brainstormed, you know, what would be interesting things to explore. And actually the first idea that popped up was the Raspberry Pi, because that's a small board that costs about $35. I believe it uses the ARM7 architecture in terms of the chip itself. And as things evolved, we are actually working with John Sampson at Honeywell. And he has been very interested in using Gumstix for a CubeSat-sized, what he calls a dependable multi-middleware processor, but it's part of a CubeSat form factor computer that would use Gumstix. So we basically started working, talking with him about the proposal. And John Sampson is working with us regarding helping us with some of the radiation analysis. in some of his previous experience with Gumstix. So he's been working with us. But that pointed us in the Gumstix direction. But as I've given talks to folks in Silicon Valley, et cetera, about this program, there's just a lot of enthusiasm because putting terrestrial technology successfully in space is a very powerful change because current rad hard technology is several orders of magnitude, more expensive, about 3 or 4 times more expensive. And it tends to be a few generations behind the state of the art in terms of what's actually in our cell phones. Right. So the idea is to successfully create a computer that's reliable, that can operate in low Earth orbit and beyond.
Now, since our school has lost connection and we don't have our students on board anymore, I figure we're going to probably wrap things up rather quickly. And I wanted to know if you had any last words of advice to any other students that are out there watching in terms of, you know, what would you suggest to them if they're interested in getting involved with science and maybe even work with a project that could go in space?
Well, I always recommend that you basically listen to what you want to do. You follow your bliss. And you don't get discouraged. I mean, we all get discouraged at times, but work through that. I have always worked in science, and I've worked on basically technology that does go into space. And it's not always easy, but I do love it, and I'm really glad I stuck with it. And things just continue to get more and more interesting. There's always opportunities that will pop up that you can take advantage of. So basically never give up on your dreams and just continue forward. And we need you. We need people who are, you know, hardworking, who are inspired to do great things, and it will benefit all of us. So I would definitely, if you love science, if you love space, pursue it, and opportunities will come up as a result.
Well, thank you again so much for taking the time out of your day to be here today. And even though Audi International is no longer connected, we thank them for the time that they were able to connect to us. And we look forward to hearing more about how their project does on the ISS as well. So thanks to all those who are watching us through the DL Info channel. And we'll be back here again next week around the same time, December. I'm in a whole other month. March 12th, we'll be talking to some of the folks who are launching on SpaceX next week, and we're going to learn about their radiation project. So it kind of ties back into this. They're looking more at the human side of radiation, though. So tune in next week on March 12th, and we'll see you then.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.